this world that would just make your mind go dizzy if you found out about them. There's one family that we know of that's worth $100 trillion. That would be the Rothschilds. They're a very, very wealthy family. And the reason they're wealthy is they are major shareholders of every major international bank on earth and have been for a long, 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 long time. And in fact, the Rothschilds, if it were known, the truth are known, have been financing militaries on both sides of the wars for decades and making their riches by financing countries and charging pretty good interest on what they loan. And so we're living in a world that has changed. When there was a poll recently taken, how many of you that are being polled, it was a nationwide poll, think that the government is honest and trustworthy and you just rest easy at night? And the numbers were rather dismal. More than 70% of America's population said they didn't have confidence or trust that the government was being ethical or honest at all times. And I think we can find that out. I mean, we see every once in a while they'll bring up a guy on charges, and all of a sudden here's a guy who's been a governor or perhaps a senator, and all of a sudden they levy all kinds of criminal charges and away they go. And there's a reason, I guess, why us as citizens began to wonder about things. But I'm still not deterred. I want you to know that no matter what the landscape looks like here, it's much better than any place else. Keep that in mind. We still have a great deal of freedom, and we want to exercise our freedom, and we want to utilize our freedom because we are the warriors that are standing on the planet between people going to hell and people not going to hell. That makes you a warrior. Whether you consider yourself a warrior or not, God says that we need to be prayer warriors first because we're going to be strongest on our knees than at any other point in our life. When I see someone who has a humble spirit and they're praying with an open heart, weeping before the Lord, I know that that's a prayer warrior. Amen? That's a person, by the way, you know, sometimes guys, I think, are afraid to feel, you know, I mean, they're afraid to let tears come once in a while. Have you ever noticed that? You see guys are a little bit afraid to pray and a little bit afraid to let a tear slip out of their eye. And the truth of the matter is, that's the language of God. When a man is serious with God and he's talking to God and he cares about people that he's praying for, and he's praying for, all kinds of things, his heart will be moved. I know that rough facade we put on for everybody else, but you got to get rid of that thing when you're talking to God. Amen? And we need to learn how to become prayer warriors. So before we start into a series of messages through the book of Revelation next week, I want us to learn how to pray because we are living in some very, very dangerous times in this world. We're living in dangerous times. Just the other day, I read in the paper a terrible incident. Two brothers, very wealthy family, a nice family, stabbed to death five members of their family, starting from age 5 years old and up, and they stabbed them to death, and one of them that was dying called 911 and got there, and a 13-year-old girl was spared. She lived through it, and a 3-year-old was left untouched. Two brothers went crazy and stabbed their family to death, 116 and 117, I mean, I think it was 15 and 17 or something like that. Just two boys. For what reason? Found them hiding in the woods. We're living in a time when young people are losing their way. We're living in a time where there are people that want to make merchandise of them with drugs and all sorts of things, and we need to be the protectors of those kids. Amen? For every family that we win to Christ, we can protect a child. I had a sheriff's officer, a female officer. She was a sergeant of the night. She just walked into our church service at the jail the other night. And I said, "Hi, how are you doing? Can I help you?" She said, "I just want to hear what you're saying to these guys." I said, "Well, come on in. We'd love to have you." And she stood there for about 20 minutes listening to what we were talking about and kind of scratched her head a little bit. And she decided, well, this was okay, and she walked away. And at least I hope we planted a few seeds in her mind. Amen? Because I said during that time, I said the hope of America is for men to find their way to God on their knees and become powerful, loving men at home so that children have a chance. So that a wife is not going to be mistreated. So that she's not influenced to take drugs. so that she stays at home and does what she's supposed to do and raises a family. Amen? And so it's important for us to start praying for our community here that whatever impact we're going to make is going to be right here. It's going to be right here in this community. We're not going to go to London and Brazil. I'm probably not going to go fight ISIS. And we're not going to be doing all these things. But we do have a battle right on our front steps. Amen? And we need to reach those people. So let me take a journey with you. And let's see. Is this thing turned on? Is it all? No, if not, it's my fault. Let's see. If not. Here, let's just do it with this. Got to back up. I think. That worked. Let's see. There we go. Okay, I think that'll work. So we need to become a people of prayer. And so as we look into this message today, being prayer warriors, there's three principles of a prayer warrior. And it's found in Ephesians chapter 6, and we'll be looking at verses 10 through 20 a bit here today. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, I want to pray, God, that as we look into this subject of prayer, that God, you'd open our mind. We pray you just open up our hearts and help us understand, because, Lord, these are good people that have gathered here. These are your children. And, Father, I want to pray, God, that we would take upon us the responsibility, Father, of caring for somebody else. Realize, Father, that we're imperfect and we claim not to be better than anyone else, but, Lord, we want to be used by you, and we want to figure out how you can control our hearts and minds to help us avoid sin and to help us be willing to reach out with love and give somebody else hope that is hopeless. And so we pray you just give us the word today in a way we can understand it, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. So, three principles of a prayer warrior. First of all, when I think of those principles, you're commanded to be a prayer warrior. God told us men ought always to pray and not to faint. We should be praying. Now, the apostles came along and they said, Lord, teach us how to pray. Well, that sounded odd to me when I first read that. I mean, these guys are apostles, right? Well, they weren't apostles then. They were just disciples. They'd just been gathered up by God, just ordinary guys walking down the street, and he gathered them together and said, follow me. He told John, I'll make you a fisher of men. He was a fisherman in the water. He said, we'll fish for men. I'm sure he wondered what that was all about. But he followed him, and God had a plan. They were becoming men, and one day they said, Lord, teach us how to pray. And they were clueless. They had been praying quite a bit. They just didn't know they had been. What is prayer? It's communication. And as they walked along, they would talk to Jesus, and they would listen to him. He would talk to them, and they would talk back. And actually, that's what prayer is. It's communicating back and forth with God, only they had him first person. Amen? And so they were praying in the best kind of prayer when he was standing there. And they were praying when he said, well, let me show you how to pray. And he gave them the tenets of prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the kingdom, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, what that was the tenets of prayer. In other words, you want to praise God. You want his will to be done here on earth. You want to have the things that you need for food and clothing. You don't want to get involved in temptation. And you certainly want to honor God all the days of your life. Amen? And you want to honor who he is. Well, he was teaching them what prayer was about. But real prayer is just simply talking to God. So when I have people and I ask them, say, hey, brother, would you lead us in prayer? And they go, me? could you pick somebody else? Well, they're nervous. Why? Because they think they don't know how to pray. Well, it's just like talking to someone else. So if you walked up into a room and you were talking to someone, that's the same thing you would do to God. You talk in your normal heart, your normal voice, whatever's on your mind, and that's what you say. Amen? So prayer. We're commanded to be a prayer warrior. There was a condition of prayer. We're going to be looking at the command to be a prayer warrior, condition of a prayer warrior, and the concentration of a prayer warrior. First of all, the command. In verse 18 of Ephesians 6, it says, praying always with all prayer and supplications, being watchful to this end with all perseverance. Now, wait a minute. Am I supposed to stay on my knees all day long and pray? Oh, no. You're just not supposed to hang up the phone. You know, the people are getting pretty good at that stuff. I see them walking around like this all day long. They're on their phone when they're walking. They're on their phone. I had a guy pass me in a Ford F-350 last night when I was going down the highway. He was locked into this, driving about 70 miles an hour, and I went, oh my gosh, you know. Well, he was praying to some friend of his, I guess, but he was talking, and so people are not hanging up their phones very much. I suggest he needs a Bluetooth. Amen? He needs something in his ear. We need to be in the habit of praying all the time. In other words, including God in your daily walk at the very, very, very smallest level. When you're out working in your garden and you're talking to God about the amazing stuff He's growing there, or if you're just going to see a friend and you're talking about your friend, Lord, I want to pray my friend's okay and that things are well with his family. Maybe you're thinking about a lost person. Maybe you're just going down the store to buy something. But you want to be involving God in that. So we're in a constant state of prayer. Now, you know the nice thing about being in communication with God all the time? It changes how you act. It sure does. How many of you when you were little kids were ornery when your parents weren't looking, but when they came around, you acted a little bit different? You know what I mean? If you knew they were there, and then sometimes you didn't know they were there and you were ornery, and oh goodness, they caught you. You know, you little rascal, and they grab your little hand and take you away from what you were doing. But you know, God says He's always with us, Christ in you, the hope of heaven. Once you've invited Him in, He's your ever-present friend. He never leaves. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I give you eternal life. Isn't that amazing? Well, He said, I just want you to talk to me. I'll never forget one time going, I think I said this here recently, that I went out into a field and asked God to speak to me in an audible voice. I had been home from Vietnam for just a short time. And I said, God, I'm in the army. They tell me what to do. It started raining. I'm standing out in the field by a house that we're renting. And we had some horses. And I was standing there. I said, God, go ahead and talk to me. I won't rat you out. Just tell me what to do. I mean, I just really want to know what to do. And I heard nothing. I got soaking wet. Felt a little bit silly when I got back to the house. You know, I was all drenched. And I didn't hear a word. But then I began to learn that if I picked up the Bible and I would pick up this blessed book, God was talking to me. His words were speaking to me, and I was learning from those words. And the interesting thing about it is when you're reading God's word, when He says something to you, you can stop. The conversation doesn't continue on while you begin to look at it and think about it and meditate on it and then reflect on it. And then you say, God, could you apply this to my heart? Amen? Have you ever been around somebody that talks so much you can't get one word in? Been around something like that? And I mean, I'm waiting, you know, you're waiting for them to take a breath so you can say goodbye, you know, and they're going on and on and on. You go, God, you're just waiting for it. I got to go. You just want to get that in, but you can't. They're just going on and on and on. Well, listen, we need to be the kind of people that enjoy being around God. By the way, I never want to stop listening to God. When I stop reading my Bible in the morning, I don't want to stop. I always want to keep reading. I got to go out and do some stuff, and I've got to get busy, I know. But I just don't want to stop. I want to keep reading, because everything He says is pure. Everything He says is right. I don't have to wonder if He's wanting to take something from me. I don't have to wonder if He's deceiving me. He's always telling me something that's filled with truth and righteousness and goodness, and it'll make me a better person. I just like to read it. And I hope that you fall in love with this book, because that's how God is going to talk to you. Amen? But He said men ought always to pray. He said with all supplications. Now, so I'm praying. By the way, when you're in your car praying, please don't shut your eyes. I don't think I found a place in the Bible where it says you must shut your eyes to pray. It just says we're supposed to communicate with God. Wouldn't it be funny if I walked up to my wife like this and said, honey, when's dinner? That'd be kind of funny, wouldn't it? I mean, you know, I communicate with my wife with my eyes open all the time. And so it's important, though, that you know you can pray when you're driving your car. You know you can pray when you're doing just about anything. You can be talking to God. When you're in the middle of a tough situation and there's someone giving you a hard time, unbeknownst to them, you can have a conversation with God right in front of them, praying for that person, that God would deal with their hearts and help them get through what they're going through, and that you wouldn't react in a bad way, and that you would keep your calm spirit, and that you would show love in place of anger. Amen? So if that prayer line is going all the time, it's a rescue effect. It's right there when you need it. It's there to keep you from getting angry. It's there to keep you from having a lustful thought. Now guys, listen, girls too. In the summertime, people are dressing down and they're provocative. And we need to be in prayer. Amen? At the moment that my mind would begin to wander, I wanted to immediately say, God, I know that that's your child. You created that person for heaven, and they don't know you perhaps. I pray that they would know you. I pray their family would know you, and just keep moving on. Amen? That makes for a healthy marriage that lasted 42 years, by the way. It works pretty good. Amen? And by the way, there are people out there, I want to tell you, I warned the men last night in the jail. Listen, guys, you need to be wary because there are a lot of immoral women who are going to try and wreck your world. I say that to the girls too. There's a lot of immoral men out there that want to wreck your world. They don't care about you. They only care about themselves, and they're not saved. And we need to be really, really watchful. Amen? We need to teach our kids and our grandkids. We need to teach others that we are always to pray. And the Bible says we're supposed to pray. What's your supplication? What do you want? So if I come up to the store, and I walk into the store, and I walk up there, and I just stand there. And they come up and they say, well, can we help you, sir? And I just came to get some stuff at the store. I said, okay. And I just stand there. Well, sir, what would you like? And you stand there looking around. You're probably not going to get any help from that guy. You're probably not going to find what you want. And God says that we come to him with our supplication, in other words, request. You come to God with request. What is it that you need? Have you got some kind of a hurt, some kind of a heavy heart? Have you got some kind of a financial need? Do you have a physical need? Do you have an emotional need? I don't care what it is, because God's store is complete. Amen? You talk about Walmart, that's got nothing on God. God has everything that you can imagine. And he wants you to constantly be asking him for the things that you need because he cares. There's nothing that I cannot and will not pray about when I'm talking to the Lord. And then he says, being watchful to this end with all perseverance. When you find yourself not talking to God, you need to be watchful and get back to that. Pay attention. Pay attention. The guys that I mention the jail a lot because I'm in there a lot talking to these guys. But I said, guys, listen, what you do in here will tell me what you're going to do out there. If you're not prayerful in here, you won't be prayerful out there. And I say that to you. If you're not prayerful out here, you might be in there. That could happen. And so it's important that we, as God's people, bring our requests to God, we get honest with God, and we bring all of those things to him continually, all the things that we need. And God says that's the first part of being commanded to be a prayer warrior. The seriousness of praying like a warrior is highlighted in the alls contained in the command. First of all, he says always. Now, I'm here to tell you that at war, and I've been in a war, there's nobody that doesn't have a prayer. Even those guys that tell me they don't believe in God, I've heard them mumbling a prayer. God, help us. God, help us. I've heard them say that. I want you to know that it's important that we pray always. God says don't minimize that. And he says always with all prayers. I want you to keep coming at me with them. You can't wear me out. And with all perseverance, don't ever quit. So once you start on the path of communicating with me, and by the way, let me tell you something. Most of my prayers, they're not desperation prayers. Oh God, you know, I it's not that. God, I love you. I tell God I love him often. God, I just want to tell you I love you. You are so amazing. I said that today when I was coming into the parking lot. I'm looking around at all the beauty, and I said, God, I love you so much. You're so amazing. Look what you've made. You overwhelm me with the wonder of what you do. I talk to him like that sometimes. I mean, sometimes I'm not even asking for nothing. I'm just saying, God, I just want to tell you how much I appreciate what you do. It's a relationship like that. And so God wants us to have those in mind in order to be a warrior in prayer. Now, this military analogy is vital for us to understand. We're at war with Satan. I'm here to tell you that Satan hates your guts. And he wants to wreck your world. He's not going to ignore you. I heard a message this morning by some guy down in San Diego, David Jeremiah. And he was talking about the war between the dragon, Satan, in this world. And let me tell you something, that guy is busy. I believe he knows he's going to spend eternity in hell. I believe he knows he's lost the battle. But I believe also that he wants to hurt God as much as he can by denying him the lives of people that could be redeemed and could be saved by keeping you messed up, by keeping you off your game, by keeping you full of pride, arrogance, rebellion, or any of that stuff, argumentative spirit, any of that stuff. Because if he can get you to act like an army person, no one's going to listen to you when it comes time to talk about Jesus. Amen? Well, that's oh me, really, but But, you know, we really need to be the kind of people that, when you choose who are going to be your friends, who do you choose? People that are happy. You choose people that are positive. They seem to care about you. You know what I mean? So that means if we want people to listen to us, we've got to have those attributes. We've got to, I could picture Jesus walking through in an area. He would come walking through, and as he came in the door, he would come in the door, and if he walked in, it'd be something like this. He would walk in with a smile and look around at the people and everything. He would have a smile on his face, and he would be inviting. I think you would feel like walking up to him. He would have this thing about him that says, wow, I care about you, and you'd want to walk up to him. Amen? Now, if he came walking in a different way, we probably wouldn't have the following we see from behind him. If he walked in like this. And walked in like, boy, don't you mess with me. I mean, I don't think he'd have anyone running up to him. Amen? It's important for us to get our hearts to a place where we have a meek and humble spirit that's full of kindness. Because the kind of warrior that we are isn't one that's going to go out hurting people. It's a tender warrior. It's a powerful warrior, full of the power of God, full of the love of God, and an inviting spirit where God's spirit reaches out and pulls people in. Amen? And so it's important for us to learn that we're at war with Satan. And believe me, he's got some tactics. Can Satan take anyone to hell that's a born-again Christian? He cannot. But I'll tell you what, he can sure keep you from helping somebody else find their way in. All he's got to do is get you filled up with yourself, thinking about me, always me. Have you ever been around someone that couldn't lose an argument?
Yep.
And then you were one too? Boy, that makes for a real good conversation, doesn't it? Two people going back and forth, and then this one's got the last word. No, this one's going to get the last word. And finally, this one goes, well, okay, and as they walk out, and then they throw something else at them, you know. And they turn around, they throw something else back and forth they go. Oh, gosh, Satan has got so many things he can use to keep us off of a walk with God, a prayer life with God. So we're at war with Satan. One reason we have such weak Christianity today is we do not pray as if we're at war. That's why Christianity is so lukewarm. We're praying like there's not a lot of bad stuff going on. Have you looked and seen what's going on in the world today? While we're standing here in safety, there are people laying on the streets minus their heads. They're being slaughtered by the thousands by ISIS right now. We're talking about men, women, boys, and girls. We're talking about things so hideous that you can't possibly bear to look at it very long. I think you told me you watched a video recently and saw something. It was so horrible that it made you ill. Was that you that told me that? And somebody watched a video of one of these people who were put to death by ISIS. I don't want to see one. And I want you to know that there's so many horrible things going on in the world right now. We've got to wake up and pray like we're at war. Amen? We've got to pray that God help me get busy and help me see somebody. I think the reason why God lets me win so many people to Christ is not me. It's just that I can't help but think, what if I never see that person again? And what if they die? And what if they wind up in hell? And I didn't even tell them. I think that's what drives me most of the time to stop people and talk to them, is because I'm afraid, well, it would be my fault. Because I didn't warn them. I didn't give them any kind of a hand up. And so I decided, you know what, if God, anytime a person walks up to me and intentionally talks to me, I know that's a signal I'm supposed to tell them how to get to heaven. Amen? If a person just walks up and says, hi, how are you doing? I know, I'm going to talk to that one. All they got to do is give me a little bit of an inroad, and we're going to have us a good conversation about Jesus. Now, they may not all give their hearts to the Lord, but they're going to know how before they leave. Another thing. Here we are used to this. I want to show you an acrostic. An acrostic is where you take the letters of a word and you teach its meaning from it. Okay, that's what an acrostic is. So let's use the acrostic. Start with praise. The first thing God wants us to know, if you're a prayer warrior, is learn how to praise God. To come and just lift up holy hands. And by the way, let me tell you something. It's not just the Pentecostal crowd that lifts up holy hands. It's God's people. Amen. If you lift up your hands and say, God, I love you, that's a worshipful thing. That's okay. I've been off by myself many times just said, God, I love you so much. We need to be a people, when we pray, we worship Him. We tell Him how wonderful He is. We tell Him of the greatness of what He has done. I get excited when I think about what God's done. God's done some amazing stuff. Amazing. I can't get over it. I literally get overwhelmed. I start thinking about plants and all the things and the planets, and I'm just going, whoa, He is too wonderful. But then I think about Him dying, and all that disappears to nothing, and I think that He died for the likes of us, that he laid down His life in my place. I am so overwhelmed I can't talk sometimes. It's amazing. Amen? And we need to just praise Him. We need to tell Him what we're thinking. You know what? How many of you girls have run into this situation? That guy that was supposed that you loved and you fell in love with, and you told him you loved him all the time, and very seldom did he ever walk up and say, I love you. And he just did that a lot. And it was kind of like the 95-year-old guy. One time his wife came and said, all these years we've been married. And she said, you don't tell me you love me. He said, I told you I loved you when I married you. If it changes, I'll let you know. They need more than that. Amen? They need to hear that you love them. Now, I know that God ponders our thoughts and He ponders our hearts and God knows us, but I think it just blesses God when we worship Him and we verbalize it. God, I love you. Amen? That we let Him know that we care and we express it by the way we live. We express our love for God. So if we're going to be a prayer warrior, we've got to learn to really be in touch with the Master. And we've got to offer Him, first of all, praise. Now, another thing when we come to R, there needs to be sometimes in your prayer life repentance. What is repentance? Someone tell me, what is repentance? Someone just shouted out.
Turn from?
Change your ways.
Huh?
Change your ways.
Change your way. Change your direction?
Turn away.
Turn away from? Those are both good illustrations. God says repentance is literally to turn your back on evil, do an about face, and go to God and say, God, I don't want to go that way anymore. God, would you take this stuff out of my heart? Take it out of my mind. I am done. I don't want to do this anymore. I think the difference between that and I'm sorry is you're just sorry you got caught. But when you repent, you're not sorry you got caught. You don't want to do it anymore. Amen? Excuse me. And so if we're going to be a prayer warrior, we have to be people that know how to praise our God in prayer. And we also need to know when it's time to have repentance, we need to be genuine about repentance. It's not like when you were a child, you were a bad boy, you got in the cookie jar. Do you promise you will never get in the cookie jar? And you crossed your fingers and put it behind your back. Uh-huh. I promise. That little boy is not repentant. He's going to the cookie jar as soon as you turn around. But God wants us to be the kind of people that says, listen, I don't want to get in the cookie jar anymore. I am tired of being disobedient. I don't like how I feel. And by the way, don't you notice when we disobey God, we feel miserable? Have you noticed the difference when you got saved? The change that happened after that? Because when you get saved, it's not fun anymore. Because God, the Holy Spirit, and He's going to remind you of what that's all about. And it's robbing you of His blessings. It's robbing you of joy. It's robbing you of the opportunity to share the love of God with somebody else. So you're not happy. But when you get close to God and when you get it right, oh wow, it's different. So we have to be a people who know how to pray with praise and pray with repentance. Also, we need to learn how to be a people that ask. You've got to bring your request and specifically say what it is that you're looking for. God knows already. No, He wants you to spell it out. He says you have not because you ask not. And then sometimes He says you ask and you don't have it because you're asking for the wrong thing. You're asking amiss to consume it upon your lust. But what He's saying is when you come to Him, He wants you to go ahead and just say, God, I want a tender spirit. I want help with this. I want to escape this part of my personality. I need physical help here. I need some emotional stability. I don't care what it is. You've got to spell it out. Because, see, if you don't name it, you're not serious enough about it yet. Amen? You're still excusing the behavior. I've had people tell me, I said, well, how's your walk doing? Well, what do you mean? Well, I mean, are you stumbling with sin? Oh, no, I make a few mistakes once in a while. And I accidentally do some stuff once in a while. I said, you do that accidentally? He said, how do you accidentally sin? Well, you know, I really don't. How do you accidentally sin? I mean, I'm curious. How do you accidentally sin? Well, you know, it just kind of creeps up on you and you do it. Well, I said, well, did you think about it? Well, yeah. Did you make a decision? Yeah. That's not an accident. That's a plan. We've got to get to the point that when we come to God and say, God, I don't want to plan to sin anymore. I want to have a plan to escape sin. I want to be a powerful son of God or a daughter of God, whatever the case may be. I want to be used by you. I want to be a light. Now, lights draw bugs. Did you know that? I know for sure that bugs come to lights. I do. When I was just about 16 years old working at the 3D cattle ranch, Corky McCorkindale, the owner of that ranch, said, can you drive a caterpillar? I wasn't a Christian yet, and I lied to him and said yes, because it would get me out of feeding all the cattle and doing all the grunt work and everything on the ranch. Oh, yes, I can drive a caterpillar, I told him. And he said, well, I'm sure you can. Come with me. And put me in his pickup, and he drove me out into the country. And there was a big D8 cat hooked up to a land plane. Never seen one in my life. And never been on a caterpillar in my life. And he looked at me and he said, now, son, I know you're an experienced caterpillar driver, but I'm very particular about how mine's driven, so let me show you how I do it. Okay. I was hoping he would leave so I could try and experiment and figure out how to make that thing move. So he knew I didn't know how to drive it. And then he turned me loose. Well, our little class went for about an hour and a half or so, and he got me. I was doing pretty good with it, knew how to make the lines and make the turns and all the stuff. And then it got dark. He said, I'll come out and pick you up when it's time to quit. He left me out there for hours with spotlights on that thing. You know what comes at spotlights? When you're down in Imperial Valley, millions of bugs come to spotlights. Millions of them. I mean, I had my shirt over my head, peeking out of a hole, trying to do it. Was terrible. But I found out there's something good about lights. If you're the light of the world, it draws people to you, and they'll come a lot too. Amen? And when they get there, you have something wonderful, and it's not unpleasant, it's very pleasant. It's a pleasant experience. How many of you have had the privilege, don't answer, but have had the privilege of leading someone to Christ and praying with them while they got saved? There's nothing like it. Amen? There's just nothing like it. It's an exciting moment when you're actually with someone and you see them step from being lost right into the family of God. They've got eternal life. If that doesn't bless you, your blesser's broke, and we'll help you fix that somehow. We'll get that thing fixed. But I'll tell you, there's nothing like that. It's a wonderful experience. God says we need to be a people who know how to praise Him in prayer, repent in prayer, and also we need to ask in prayer. And finally, we need to be a people that yield in prayer. In other words, when you come to God, you need to come with such an open spirit. You say, God, I'm not here to advise you. I'm here to ask you to show me what to do. I will do anything you want me to. Anything. Anything. You know, when you come to that point where you're willing to do anything for God, you'll find out that there's a whole lot of somethings He'll bring into your life. He will bring people to you that are hurting. He will do all kinds of wonderful things. He'll have you do things for people. He'll have you stop and help people. I had a guy run up to me the other day. I was on my motorcycle coming back from the gym, and he ran up to me and he said, Pastor, Pastor. And he had a young woman with him, and he had a little boy, and I recognized him. He had gotten saved in the jail some months earlier. I've been trying to do it right. He said, I'm panhandling all day to get enough money to stay in the motel for the night for my family, and I don't have time to go to work. He said, I don't know what to do. He says, I'm just so stressed out. What can I do? I said, well, first of all, walk down to the pizza parlor. I'm going to go buy you guys a pizza right now. That's the first thing. Let's just go take care of that. And they went down there, and I bought them a nice pizza, and I sat down, and I talked to the little five-year-old boy, cute little boy. The young woman told me she was already a Christian, and I said, are you guys married? No, we're not. I said, well, I'd be glad to help you with that. We can take care of that, and if you want to do that, let me know, and we'll fix that up for you. And then I said, listen, I'm going to go down and buy you some groceries. I'm going to get you some food and something to drink. And I went, and I got all this stuff and came back, and they were gone. They were just gone. I looked everywhere. I drove for a couple hours all over town looking for them. And I said, Lord, I wonder why you didn't let me find them. I don't know. I won't know probably for who knows. But you see, the intent was that I did what God told me to do. It didn't matter. Amen? And I said, perhaps I'll see them in a day or two. Maybe some other situation will come up, and then I can take them the food then. But I want you to know, you need to come to God yielded and say, God, what is it about me that you want? What do you want? Do you want more of my time? Do you want more of my time in the Word? Do you want more of my time to talk to others? Do you want more of my time in my family? And by the way, that's a big one. We need to interact with our families more. Amen? We need to interact with them. We need to let them know we love them. We need to let them know we're there for them and that we care. That's the starting point. Because if you get real busy helping a bunch of people on the outside and you're not being very close to the people on the inside, that makes them feel pretty bad. You know what I mean? God wants us to be the kind of people that are yielded. We come to God not advising him. How many of you saw the thing, Lou Giglio's thing about all the planets, how big they are and how big God is? How many of you seen it? Can I see your hand? Quite a few of you. And there's one thing he saw when it was really, really cool. One of the funniest parts of that whole thing was he said he saw that this planet was huge. It was a huge planet. It was called Betelgeuse. And he said Betelgeuse would hold something several hundred trillion Earths inside it. And he said, that stumped me. He said, up until then, he said, I was advising God, drawing diagrams for God, and you know, and counseling God. He said, after that, I was just dumbstruck. And I'm saying, God, would you teach me some things? You know. He said, because God breathed stars like that out of his mouth. And we need to be the people that go with a yielded spirit and say, God, I don't come to you telling I have any rights. I'm not going to tell you I've got it figured out. I'm coming to you with just an open heart. I don't have it figured out, God. You're God. I'm just your child. I'm just created by you. And I'm open. Teach me your ways. Teach me your ways. Open my heart and mind. Help me not fixate on negatives. Help me look at positives. Help me be a person that somebody wants to come to and be around. Use me, God. I'm yielded. We must use them all of those. We need to be engaged in all of those at the same time if we're going to be a warrior. They're all necessary and a part of fighting and standing. Well, where would your Christian life be without one of these types? If you lose one of those things, you're going to be crippled in some area. You need all of those things. And so God says we need to add them all together and keep doing them, being a prayer warrior. Now, when we're talking about being a prayer warrior, there's several things in Ephesians that we find there. But we start in Luke, first of all, before I run over to Ephesians. Watch, therefore, and pray always that ye may be counted worthy to escape all the things that will come to pass and stand before the Son of Man. It's more so important for you right now than the average generation. If I had said this to a generation that was going to die in the 1800s, it was tough, but not nearly as tough as what you're going to face. I'm here to tell you that we're living in times when this government of ours, and I'm not talking about any particular politician, but our government as a whole, is erasing the name of God from all of their facilities. It's being erased. We're seeing our land start changing. You were talking about being down in San Francisco and saw things that was so degrading and so debasing that you couldn't even talk about it in public. We're talking about permissions being given to children to change their gender. They've got a TV show on it now on the Learning Channel where they castigate 19 kids and counting over something that happened 12 years ago and was a minor thing. And yet they're promoting transgenderism and gay lifestyles, and we're seeing the world losing its way. America's no different than any place else. It's losing its way. You can go out on the average outing and run up to a teenager and say, do you know who Jesus Christ is? You may be surprised to find that many of them say, no, who is he? I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ is trying to be, our world is erasing him from their midst. You know why? Because it's not very comfortable to live in front of a God who points out your sin. And so they want to avoid that. We're living in the last days. To be a prayer warrior, and it's so important. Now, one of the things that will help you in prayer is fasting. How many of you ever experienced fasting and prayer? You ever experienced that? Let me tell you something. There are times when you have such a heavy situation, a problem that's so big, and you've prayed about it, and it seems like nothing is happening one way or the other, and you may need to do some fasting and get focused on what's going on, because if you'll do without some food for a while, if you'll go a day or 2 days or even 3 days or 4 days and don't eat and give yourself to prayer and give yourself to focusing on that and talk to God about it, I promise you, you're going to notice something different happening in that situation. It's so important. There are times when you have to do that. And so, let's take a look into this a little bit more. Another method for prayer is fasting. The reason for fasting is to add intensity and focus and to use it through the fast. Now, Jesus did tell us, he said, when you fast, don't be as the publicans who make a big show of it. And they want you to know, oh, no, no, I can't have your food. I'm fasting for the Lord. And we don't want that. You know, oh, no, no, thank you for dinner, but no, I'm fasting. Bless God, I'm fasting for God. I don't want that happening. But when you're fasting, God says, don't walk around like this either. I'm hungry. I can't eat. No, I'm so hungry. Don't do that either. God said, when you're fasting, wash your face and hands. Put a smile on your face. Go about your business. Don't tell anybody you're fasting. If they offer you something, say, no thanks. Thank you for the offer, but no thanks. With a smile on your face, keep going about what you're doing. And when you're alone with God, you're going to find out that your focus and your concentration with God will get much more astute. And you will pray with intensity like you've not prayed probably before. And so if you ever run into maybe there's someone that's not saved that you care about desperately, and you've tried to talk to them and they won't listen to you. You've tried to start, nope, that's not us. Listen, you like religion, I love you, but I ain't going to talk about that. Back off. No, we've got those, don't we? We've got those people in our lives that are going to do that to you. And you care about them, and you can't stand the thought of them burning in hell. Maybe you ought to try fasting and praying for them. If you care enough for them to miss a few meals, you'd be surprised what God's Spirit may be doing to track them down and bring it to a point. Amen? It's important. Now, Jesus, when he was driven out into the wilderness, there in Matthew chapter 4, and as he went out in the wilderness, he fasted already 40 days. And 40 nights. Can you imagine 40 days and 40 nights with no food? And he got out in the wilderness. Do you think you might be a little weak after 40 days? I don't know about you, but I like to eat. Anybody like barbecue? I mean, I like to eat. I got to tell you, I just like to eat. And to go 40 days without food, I think you would be really weak. I think you wouldn't have much strength left. And I think you'd be really weak. And I think anything would really look good about that time. Jesus was very weak, and Satan knew it. And let me tell you something. Satan attacked him, but there was power there. You see, he was fasting with intensity. He was dealing with God. But let me tell you something. When you're fasting, you'll be so focused. You'll be so focused on what it is that you're asking for that you'll get real serious in your asking, and you will be relentless. You will not quit. You will ask, and you will ask, and you will ask. You know, how many of you have had somebody ask you for something and you didn't want to do it? They wanted you to loan some money and you wouldn't do it. And they just kept pestering you. And they just kept pestering you. And they kept pestering you. I've got a little granddaughter named Elena who's now 18 and she's going to go to college. And I'm so proud of her. She's grown up to be a lovely young woman. She's going to be a nurse. And we'd go through the store and she'd say, Papa, can I have that? Can I have that? And I say, no, sweetheart. I'm in a hurry. Papa, can I have it? Please, Papa. I'll get it for you next time. I'm in a hurry. Papa, please. And okay, let's go get that. I'd get it for her and I'd buy it for her. Because she just kept asking. She wouldn't quit asking. And she figured that out. And one day I told her, I said, you know, if you'll go like this and you flood your eyes, I can't. Oh, that just gets me. I can't say no. She did that till she was 13. She was persistent. And see, God wants us to know that when you fast and you get serious about something, you will have the power of God in your life, and you will ask with faith, and you will ask with intensity, and you will believe that you're going to receive, and you're not taking no for an answer. God, I'm going to keep asking until you tell me this is not right to ask for. I'm asking for this. I'm not demanding, I'm asking, Father, but I'm not going to quit asking until you tell me it's the wrong thing to ask for. Pray. There was the apostle one day were trying to cast demons out of a man. This man's child was had fits and throw himself down and would bite himself and was out of control. And they went and tried to cast the demons out and they couldn't. And the Lord cast the demons out of the child. And he was normal and right. And he said, Lord, why couldn't we cast out the demon? He said, some go out, but not by prayer and fasting. Amen? So it's important that sometimes if you've got a very serious thing, if you're going to be a prayer warrior, you may want to fast. It's a way to become warrior-like in my prayer intensity. And then the second is condition of prayer is praying in the Spirit. What's praying in the Spirit all about? Included in this is a command, is the condition necessary to be a prayer warrior. You can't just decide to be a warrior. You must be prepared to do so. But what is praying in the Spirit? Well, I mean, you can pray out of the Spirit, and you can pray in the Spirit. What's that all about? I mean, what's that about? Well, let's define the word, what in the Spirit means in Ephesians. It speaks of the Holy. It speaks often of the Holy Spirit to help me understand this. It's how you're praying, not necessarily what you're praying. In Ephesians 6:18, it says, praying always, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for the saints. So it's not necessarily what you're asking for, it's how you're asking for it. Are you asking with a yielded spirit? Are you letting your spirit pray? Are you actually saying, God, from my spirit, I'm asking this, this is what I need. And it's not a selfish prayer. It's something that really is, you feel strongly God wants you to ask for. Your spirit is engaged with God. And so you're praying in the Spirit. And it's how you're praying. You're praying with a yieldedness, with a reverence, with a trust, with a faith. And then I found this really, really interesting chart. Let me break it apart for you. I think I can blow up pieces of it for you here. In Ephesians 6:12, it says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. So God tells us that we have to have the whole armor of God on. When you pray in the Spirit, that's how you put on the armor. If I'm praying in the Spirit, I get armored up. If I'm praying in the Spirit for God's power, I'm getting covered up. Amen? If I'm praying for more faith, I'm getting a shield. If I'm praying for boldness, I get a sword, the Word of God in my hand, wherewith I can go out and talk to people about God. When I'm praying in the Spirit, righteousness comes to me, and I've got the breastplate of righteousness. And I'm able to do the very work of God. So it's how we put the armor on. Praying in the Spirit puts on the armor and the power that makes it work. Let's take a look. The helmet of salvation. Ephesians 6:17, Isaiah 59:17, all these verses talk about the helmet. Now, let me ask you this. How many of you, when you got saved, realized you got a helmet? Nothing can take it away from you. You're guarded there. Amen? He said, I give you eternal life. You will never perish. Listen, if we just left right now and that's all we knew, we had eternal life and we're going to live forever, that'd be enough to float your day all day and a bunch of them after that. Amen? It's not the end when I die. I recently saw an atheist professor, and he gave a talk. He said he came home, he'd been married for 22 years, and he was an atheist, and he spread his atheism to the students in the university. He let everybody know there's no God. There's only what you can know. There's only science. There's only intellectualism. And all these so-called Christians, they're just a weak people with a crutch. And then he came home one day, and suddenly he felt a burning in his stomach. And he didn't know it, but he had a perforated stomach and blood began to flow through it and he was dying, he was bleeding out in his stomach. They rushed him to the hospital. He lived in an area where they said, we need a specialist to do something for you. And they came back 8 hours later and said, we can't find a doctor, but there'll be one tomorrow. He said, inside, I was scared to death. I was afraid of dying because that means it's it, this is it, no more of me. I just vanished and I'm gone. And he said that suddenly, he found himself, his wife was crying at the foot of the bed. He found himself standing next to her. And he said, and he walked over and he looked at the bed and he saw someone that looked at him and it looked like him. And he walked over and he yelled at his wife, who is that in the bed? He said, she ignored me. And I yelled at her and I thought she could hear me. I thought she was just ignoring me. His spirit was out of his body. He heard a soft voice saying, come with us, come with us, come with us. He said he walked to the door of the hospital and went right through it. And it was a dark, dingy, dark hallway, and he said, as they were motioning, come with us, come with us. And then pretty soon they started getting mean and angry, and it became more and more intense, and they were yelling epithets at me, and they were saying horrible things, and they began to pull at me and tear at me and scream at me and beat me. And he said, I knew I was where I was supposed to be because I had lived a mean and selfish life. I knew I was going to hell. He said, in 1 second, I fell down and cried out, dear God, please help me. Jesus, please save me. Evidently, there was a little bit of life left still there. And God put him back in his body, and he opened his eyes. he is now a flaming evangelist for Jesus Christ. Amen? And he's a man of great prayer. Because he's a man that knows the perils of people who will leave this world and what they're getting ready to face. And he prays intensely for people. He's a prayer warrior. He's a man that knows how to pray. So the helmet of salvation, that's in the family of God. Another thing that you put on when you pray in the Spirit is the belt of truth. You become very honest. Amen? You won't steal a penny. You wouldn't take a penny from someone if they paid you a dollar to do it. You just wouldn't do that. Amen? And that's what happens to us, God says. We get the belt of truth. We're honest with ourselves. We're honest about the things in the world. And God says, praying in the Spirit will let you have that belt. Also, as we're putting on our armor, we're also going to get the shield of faith. In Ephesians 6:16, it says, also take the shield of faith, which is able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. If you think he's not throwing darts at you, you just don't know him. Now, by the way, back in those days, they had shields before they were metal, that they were tightly woven, things that were woven. And they would throw fiery darts at them, and they could burn them up. But God says, I'll give you a shield that'll stop all the darts, stop the fire, it'll stop everything. Amen? I'll give you the shield of all shields. I'll give you my shield. And he said, when you pray in the Spirit, you also are putting on the breastplate of righteousness in Ephesians 6:14. The breastplate of righteousness, you know, doesn't it feel good when you're walking with the Lord and you might not have made money on a deal, but you did something right and you did it right, but you walk away feeling happy about it. Maybe you helped somebody and you lost money doing it, but you felt good doing that. Amen? Or maybe someone overpaid you at a counter and they gave you $20 instead of $5 in change and you stopped. And maybe you were a little short on money that day and it could have helped you a little bit, but you turned around and you said, you know, you're going to be short on your till, and you just took the $20 back and you said, you gave me way too much. You know how you feel inside? That's that breastplate of righteousness which is helping you. Amen? You're truthful and you've got a righteousness about you, and people look at you and the teller looks at you and goes, well, that was very nice of you. And they act kind of surprised. They don't know how to react to that. And so God says, when you pray in the Spirit, you get a breastplate of righteousness. When you pray in the Spirit, you also get the sword of the Spirit, and that's this right here. Let me tell you something. How many of you carry this around like this all day long? Say, so when you run into somebody, excuse me, come here, I want to tell you about what's in this book. I don't think many of us do that. Amen? Or how many of you, when you're in a situation and you need God's advice, you go, hold that thought, I got to run home and get my Bible, open that up and figure out what's going on here. Just a minute, I'll be back in about an hour. You don't do that either. You don't carry it with you all the time, but if you put it in your heart, it's always there. Amen? So God says that you need to memorize His Word. Praying in the Spirit, ask God, help me memorize this. Help me know these words. Help me remember these stories. God, I want to use these. I want to use them on me first, and I want to use them to help other people. Faith comes by, remember last week, faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the Word of God. And so our faith gets increased every time we look into the book. We get stronger, more powerful, more able as a soldier. And also when you pray in the Spirit, did I miss it? I made it small, what I did. Okay. We also get the shoes of the gospel of peace, Ephesians 16. You know what that means? That means you're prepared to go anywhere at any time and tell a soul about Jesus. There have been times, literally, when God has stopped me, I'm going this way, and I just see somebody, and I wonder if they know Jesus, and boy, don't think that, because if you do, God will make you turn around and go back and stop what you're doing and talk to Him. Amen? Because He said, I want you to be prepared to go wherever you need to go. Missionaries have gone around the world with this very, very thing. They've gone and rewritten the Bible in languages of people that didn't know the Bible. These are people that have traveled and literally done without. They've lived in huts. They've lived in tough situations to tell the people about Jesus. And God says, I want you to be prepared to go. But right now, He said, first of all, my Spirit will come upon you and you're going to be witnesses both in Jerusalem. This is our Jerusalem. Judea, that's Yuba-Sota County. Samaria, perhaps San Diego, Sacramento, you know, wherever we happen to go. But God wants us to be prepared to go, and wherever we go, we're never off duty. Amen? were off duty. I had a guy come to the jail the other night, and you ought to see this guy. He's had a rough life. He's all tatted up. He had big loops in his ears. He was all excited. He came in, he came walking, and you could tell he'd been doing drugs for years. He just still got the walk about him, and that's him, coming out there. He said, Pastor Larry. I said, what? He said, guess what? I took one of those tracts you gave me. I said, yeah. He said, I read it to my wife through the visiting glass, and she got saved. I said, wow, that's wonderful. He said, I read it to another guy in the dorm, and he gave his heart to Jesus. And he said, I like this. Let me tell you something. When you get the shoes, and you get to go and tell somebody else about Jesus, it gets pretty exciting. Amen? That made my whole night. That was a great service that night. What a way to start a service. Amen? Well, listen, I'm gonna conclude here. I want you to know that God loves you with a never-ending love. He's ever present with you. He just wants you to chat with him and talk with him all the time. He wants you to include him in what you're doing. And the Bible says, whatsoever you find to do in word or deed, do all in the name of Jesus Christ. You know, you can't do anything wrong if it's not in the name of Jesus. Well, Jesus, in your name, I'm just going to drive 85 down the highway today. It don't work. He'll have a CHP find you real quick. Well, Jesus, in your name, I just think I'll stop by and just have a beer. I mean, after all, just one beer. You can't do that. And so God says, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, and you'll find yourself making yourself a servant of the Most High and a warrior for God. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer as we conclude. Father, I want to thank you today, Lord, that we could talk about this very, very important subject, prayer. We need to be a people of prayer, God. We want right now, we pray, Father, for, I'm thinking of a small nation right now that's surrounded by enemies. Lord, we want to pray today for Israel. Lord, right now, you said in the last days that we would see the enemies and the nations around Israel would be there to hurt her, and that's what's going on right now. And we're praying for that nation that you would give your protection, that you would watch over them, that you'd protect them, protect their borders. And Father, we pray for the very people that are in the armies that would attack and kill Christians and the Jewish people. We pray for them, God, because they don't know. They don't know who you are. And we pray that somehow the glorious gospel, the glorious light of truth could break through to them. We think of all these people, Father, stuck down in San Francisco, and they think they won such a great victory through the Supreme Court, but God, they lost because the standard that was showing them that it was so wrong has been removed. And Lord, we pray for them, Father. We pray that somehow you might reach into these. There's a boy, there's a girl, there's a young man, there's a young daughter that a parent is brokenhearted about, living in that lifestyle. And Lord, they're lost. And we pray that somehow your light would break through to them. They might be saved. Lord, we're small in number here, but we're your children, God, and one with you is a majority. We stand here, Father, knowing the host of heaven stands with us. And we ask you to let us go out, Father. Let us be the light of your love. Let us be the kindness of your hands. Let us be the helper that you want to be to someone who's destitute and hurting today. So, Father, we pray that you would build us and help us search our own hearts right now, God. If there's any wicked way in us, let us be a people that are prepared to repent. We do praise you, Father. We praise you for who you are and so much that we don't understand about you, God. We're so unable to comprehend all that you are. We praise you and we love you. And as we turn to you and ask you to examine our heart, God, if there's attitudes in us, if there's inconsistencies in us, God, we want to lay them down in front of you. We want to deal with this stuff, God. We want to be people that can be used of God, powerful prayer warriors. Help us bond together to pray for America. We lift America up before you, Father. America's in trouble. She's hurting and you know what's going on. And God, I pray for the people in this great land, Father. I pray, God, for them to find you. And I pray, Father, as long as we're here, God, that you'd protect our land and keep it free, Father, so we can proclaim the name of Jesus Christ freely without persecution. And Father, I pray for the families of everyone here. Lord, there's an aunt, there's an uncle, perhaps a cousin, maybe a brother, perhaps a child, I don't know. Somebody connected, maybe a parent that doesn't know Jesus. And Father, here are your children, God, and they love their families and they need them to know Jesus. And we pray for them. God, I pray that not one of their family members would slip away from this earth without knowing you. Father, I just want to ask, God, that you would move each of our hearts to be prayer warriors. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. How many of you would say today that God's touched my heart about some needs in my life, and I'd really like you to pray for me in the closing prayer. Could I see your hand? Just slip it up. Yes, God bless you, and you, and you. Another hand over here. God bless you. I see your hand. You may put them down. Maybe you're here today, but you'd say, Pastor, I know one thing for sure. I'm positive of one thing. I remember the day I received Christ as my Savior. I'm positive I would go to heaven if I died right now. Slip your hand up as a testimony to God's saving grace. You're positive. God bless you. You may put your hand down. Maybe you were here and you didn't raise your hand. I appreciate your honesty. You weren't sure. If you slip up your hand for 1 second, I won't embarrass you, I promise you. Just slip up your hand and say, Pastor, I'm not sure. But pray for me. You slip your hand up for a second and put it back down. God bless you. Perhaps you're looking on the internet and you're not sure you'd go to heaven if you died right now. At the conclusion of our service, I'll give you some instructions where you can go on our website to find the information that you so desperately want to know. Right now, for our people, I'd like to ask us all to stand for a minute. And we're going to play. Just put something on. Put some music on. Something. That's fine. Just lay this music on. That's fine. We've got some chairs down here. It's an old-fashioned altar. And I don't care what your burden is. I don't care how little or how big. I want you to come down and just talk to Jesus about it. Just get rid of it. Amen. By the way, everybody here knows we're all imperfect. So if you've got a need in your heart, you feel free to come right now. While we wait, you just come down and our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You come on down, just anyone at all. Come on down and talk to me if you want to pray with me. If you don't know the Lord, you're certainly welcome to come. Father in heaven, we want to thank you again for this service. We want to thank you for this day, for the opportunities you've given us. We want to thank you, Father, for every heart, for every need that was mentioned by the raising of a hand. And as you look down deep in the heart of those needs, I pray for victory and deliverance. I pray, Father, for more dedication. I pray, Father, for more perseverance. I pray, God, that you would raise up here an army of prayer warriors that would pray, Father, continually. That we wouldn't quit praying. We'd leave the phone line on, Father. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
God bless you. You're dismissed. For those of you...